appreciate this opportunity so much that we can pray. Father, we do thank you for the dads that are here today. We ask you to give them a good day. Bless them and their families, the needs that may be there, the strength that may be needed. Whatever the situation is, we ask you to bless each father that is here this morning, and that maybe this morning we hope and pray that something will be said and done that will encourage their hearts. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for being our Heavenly Father. Thank you, Lord, for loving us no matter what and loving us first. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Be seated. Most of you will remember the occasion in Joshua chapter 24, verse 15, where Joshua said, "And if it is evil," talking to the Israelites here, "and if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord." Aren't you glad to be a part of the family? Great song. It's called the Family Prayer Song, and there are verses and everything to it. But I just kind of want us that whole thing with Joshua coming to the children of Israel, say, look, God's done a lot for you. You know, he sacrificed a lot for you. Getting across the Red Sea, you know, through the desert. You know, now if you don't want to serve him, that's okay. But decide. And I think sometimes God says that to us. We need to decide what we're going to be as Christians. Are we going to serve God the way we need to serve God, or are we just going to kind of play? And so, I don't know. That was my sermon for the day. I'm sorry. I had to do that. But Paul wrote in Philippians chapter 2, "Do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain." He's just saying, Christians, this is part of what we're doing, to be blameless in the eyes and in this world. As I read that one thing, I'm going, well, you know, we live in a crooked and twisted generation, you know, and so we need to. God give us Christian homes. Let's sing together.
Please.
Let's be the tie that binds. Let's stand together as we sing the first, second, and third. Thank you. You may be seated.
I'm going to do the pulpit mic. It's all right. Thank you. Mother's Day, I introduced my Roses Are Red poetry to you, and I've got one today for Dad's. It's not as good as the one I did for Mom's. I don't think it is. But I think it says a lot, maybe to dads that are here. Roses are red, violets are blue. Your dad is losing his hair over you. I have two or three more, but I'm going to spare you from those. One of my favorite stories is the son going to see his dad in the nursing home, and he goes in and he says, "Dad, how are you doing today?" He says, "Well, my legs don't work. My feet go to sleep. My back is hurting. I'm half blind. I'm half deaf. My memory is not good anymore, especially with names. By the way, what is your name, son?" "Days, I don't know what today is, but I look at it this way, life is good. I still have my driver's license." In Luke 15, we have a story of a dad, and it's a very powerful story. And most of my ministry, I have preached on it from a spiritual point of view, because it illustrates so clearly Father and Son, the Heavenly Father desiring all of us to come home and to come home to Him. It's a beautiful story, but today we're going to look at it a little differently, still looking at it from the Heavenly Father point of view. I want to read to you Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 27. I have this entitled, "The Lessons for a Father." I think they're pretty good lessons. I've been one now for 45 years, I think. So it takes one to know one. I remember when I first showed up at my first church at Slocum. This was before Charlotte. I was 18 when I went to this church, and it was my very first Father's Day at this church, and I preached on how to raise your children. That was the dumbest thing I have ever done. 18 years old and get up and preach a sermon on how to raise your kids. After the service, one of our older men came up to me and he said, in a very respectful way, "Brother Teddy, when you get married and have kids, you will throw that sermon away." Oh, man, I won't ever forget that day. I've done some dumb things. That's one of them. That's one that has always stayed with me. If you have your Bibles, stand in respect to the reading of the Word of God. Let's read this story in Luke 15, starting with verse 11. He said, "A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me.' And he divided unto them his living. Not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance in righteous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed hogs. And when he would have filled his belly with a husk that the wine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, 'How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants.' He rose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, ran and fell on his neck, kissed him. And the son said, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and no more worthy to be called thy son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring forth the best robe and put it on him, put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and alive again. He was lost and is found,' and they begin to be merry." Listen to this. "Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, 'Your brother has come home, and your father has killed the fatted calf.'" And in verse 28, he was very angry. Remain standing for prayer if you don't mind. Father, thank you for your precious word. Thank you, Lord, so much for being able to read it, see it, hear it. Bless this message to everyone that's in need this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to be very down to earth. Of course, that's about all I try to do anyway. Nothing fancy about me, but very down to earth, very elementary about the lessons for a father. I pulled every one of these from this story, and I want you to see, number one, there's a very first lesson you see in this story. Number one, fathers are just as important as mothers. Now, please don't get me wrong. I believe the mom is very, very important. There were things that I could not do that only Charlotte could do. And she did it well. Many of us, we have moms or we've had moms, and we remember how special she was. But when you look at this story, I think right off the bat, there's something that you notice in this story. I know it's a spiritual message from Jesus, but there's something very, very noticeable in this story. The mother is silent. The father, of course, being the symbol, the illustration that Jesus wanted to use here as the Heavenly Father. But still, I find it interesting that the mother here is silent. This story illustrates the fact that the father had a very strong presence in the home. And you think about that just for a second. I'm sure there are some of us who were raised in a situation that the fathers were not in the home. There was not a strong presence of the father. But here in this story, right off the bat, you see a dad that is in charge. You see a dad that he's in control of the situation. You see a dad that's very, very noticeable. And he's dealing with his two boys in this story. What I like about this, it reminds us of the truth. Even though fathers are just as important as mothers, it reminds us of the truth that it takes both in the home. Not just one. It takes the mom. It takes the dad. And you know, my hat is off to any single parent. I've heard stories. I've been told. I've had prayer requests directed toward me about their situation. My hat is off for any parent that has to be it all, so to speak. But here we see that God has designed the fact that the father is just as important as the mother, and the mother is just as important as the dad. It takes both father, mother, male, and female. We have to be real careful what we say today. Isn't that sad that it can be categorized as something else, but hey, we need to say it from time to time. And it is true in the Bible that God has designed it this way, created male and female, husband and wife, father and mother, and boy howdy, it takes two of them. I remember in the early years, we had three boys. We have three boys. We have three grown men, but there was a time when we had three small boys. The last two were, I don't know, it seemed like, I know, it just seemed like maybe they were 9 months apart. I don't know, how far apart? 18? Nah, I think you're wrong on that one, Charlotte. Oh, me, I mean, you see the point? I mean, great day. The last two, I'll never forget when Charlotte came to me and told me that she was pregnant with the third one. I thought we just had one. But they seemed so close together, and it was difficult, very difficult. Sunday mornings were always difficult for the pastor and his wife and family. I've always said Sunday morning is the most difficult time for a family to do anything. If the devil is going to get involved, if he's going to participate, it will be Sunday morning when you're trying to get your children, whether it's children or grandchildren, ready for church. And it was no different for me, being a preacher. And Charlotte's in the bathroom trying to get ready. And I love her to death, don't get me wrong. But Charlotte, it takes her forever. It takes her forever. It takes her an hour and a half to watch the show 60 minutes. I mean, that illustrates that she just takes her time. And, you know, I'm trying to think about Sunday morning message. I'm trying to think about church. And these boys are just about to drive me crazy. Then trying to get all three of them and get them in the car. It's like pinning up little pigs. One to get out, the other one to get out. It was something. Here's my point. I couldn't have done it without Charlotte. Oh, my. I don't see how some parents, especially if they're single, whether it's three or whether it's one, I don't see. But I will say this for dads. Dads, from this illustration in Luke 15, you see a very strong presence of the Father. Dads, have a strong presence in your home. You say, well, my kids are all grown. You got grandkids, you still can do it. Have a strong presence in your home. I have not retired from being a father or being a grandfather. Charlotte and I both, we participate very much with our children. We are there. Ball games, you name it. We make sure that there is a strong presence. I make sure as a man and as a preacher and a longtime pastor, I make sure that they know I'm there. My kids understand that. They know that. It's a testimony to them. There's something about having a stable, strong presence of a man in the home. It's just something about that. That's what you see here. So let this be the lesson number one, dads. Number two, the second lesson, fathers don't have perfect children. And the last part of that I'll tell you in just a moment. But let's talk about that just for a moment. Fathers don't have perfect children. Look at this story. In Luke 15, there's two sons. One is rebellious. He goes down to New Orleans on Bourbon Street and spends his dad's inheritance. I mean, he blows everything, lives in the gutter. There's another son. He stays home. Isn't that interesting? He stays home working in the fields. But at the end of the story, we find out that this kid had problems too. He was very jealous over his brother. And I've often wondered, why was that? Why did he get so upset in verse 28? I think that was his calf that the dad killed. I mean, who took care of it while the other son was away? Who fed it while the other son was away? That's just my take on it. But nevertheless, what I wanted you to see would be that you have two sons in this story. One is rebellious, one stays home, but he sure ain't perfect. How different kids can be in a home. Have you noticed that? The same parents, same teaching, same raising, same. Go down the list, same, and one can turn out this way and the other one can turn out that way. I guess what I'm saying or asking, when we think about dads, this is one of the subjects that's very difficult for dads. And the question would be, do you have a prodigal? Do you have a son or a daughter that is away from God, away from the church, away from everything that you've ever taught? and try to influence. You know Franklin Graham, and Franklin is such a, he's just awesome. I've met him twice. It's almost like being around his daddy. It's amazing. But Franklin used to be something else. And if you ever want to read a good book on how to deal with your prodigal, get that book by Franklin Graham. I'm not sure about the title, but it's a picture of him on a motorcycle. He lived some rough, rough days in his life. He gave his mama and daddy literally trouble, trouble, trouble. Dads, stop beating yourselves up. You say, I've got a prodigal. Teddy, you're talking to me. I don't know what I did wrong. One thing, stop beating yourself up. It happened to Billy Graham. It's happened to God's best people. And that's the one thing you need to do to start with. Just stop beating yourself up. How we look at other family situations. This is something else we do, even as a church. And the children are not perfect, especially the preacher's kids. All people, you know, talk. Well, none of your children are perfect. And I'll tell you this, and I'm talking to myself. If you have good children, you're blessed. And don't you dare say, well, I did it the right way. You know, I'm this and that. And I kept them in church and I did. Well, you might have done all those things. But how do you answer for people that do all those things and they still turn out to be rebellious? You can't do that. What you can do is that if you have good children, thank God, you're blessed. You're blessed. In Luke 15, I want you to see something else. Dads are not perfect either. That's that second part. Children don't have perfect fathers. And give your dad a break. Is there anybody here, don't raise your hand, but anybody here mad at your daddy? Anybody here have a problem? Did you know people have a problem with their father even into their 50s and 60s? You know, being, you know. Is there anyone here? You have a problem with that. You've not ever been able to get over that. My dad was not perfect. And it has troubled me all these years as I've looked back and had wished that my daddy had treated me a little different, especially with me preaching. He never supported me. He never supported me. Never could understand what I was doing. When we went to New York, my dad never understood why we went to New York. He couldn't see it no other way fact that I'm going to hurt my family. I'm putting my kids at risk. I'm putting Charlotte at risk. That's all he could think about. And I struggled with that for so many years. But I've had to come to the place that I've had to accept the truth. My dad was not perfect. And I believe that my dad did the best he could with what he had at the time. And I've had to let it go. And there may be some of you here today, you may need to realize, looking back over your childhood and whatever you had to be exposed to, you need to let some of that stuff go. If you don't, it'll follow you all the way to your grave. And you don't want that. The third lesson we see in this story in Luke 15, I want to read verse 20. Again, if I could. And verse 20, talking about the son arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, this caught my eye. When he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion. I can imagine, this is number three. Here's a lesson. Fathers long to have their children to come home. Don't we? I can imagine this dad here in Luke 15, verse 20. I can imagine every day he went down to the end of the driveway to the mailbox and looked down the road to see if his boy was coming home. Can't you imagine that? That's what the scripture says in verse 20. It says he saw him a long ways off. The dad was looking for him. The dad never stopped looking for him. There's an old song, and I know you remember this. It's entitled, or it says, and I quote, come home, it's supper time. And there is something about those words that resonates with all of us. Some of the greatest times to go home is when it's supper time. The supper's on the table and everybody's gathered around the table. It's time to come home. Every father longs for their child to come home. When TJ was in Colorado, and I know I've told you part of this story, he called me and told me that everything had worked out. He was being able to come back to South Alabama. And told me when he was leaving. It was in the month of January. I won't ever forget that. He said, Dad, I had to rent the largest U-Haul truck I could find, and I will be pulling our car behind the truck. He was married, Jessica. They'd already had their first son, Jason. And he called me and said, Dad, we're heading home. It's going to probably take us 3 days, maybe a little bit longer because of the weather and everything else. I'm telling you the truth. Every day and every night I walked out of my house and I went down the driveway and I looked down the road to see if I could see a U-Haul truck coming. Every day I looked, I couldn't hardly wait for my son to be home. I will never forget that sight when he drove up in that big old truck, dirty snow all over the place, still frozen to the bottom of the truck, but he finally came home. Do you have a prodigal today? I think the lesson here, if you look at the lesson in verse 20, if you have a prodigal that needs to come home, and I'm talking about to the Lord, to the church, the lesson here is found in verse 20. Don't give up. Keep going to the driveway and keep looking down the road. Don't give up on your prodigal. There are many parents and grandparents today that have had to struggle for a long time, and they finally came home. That's one of the most wonderful feelings, is when your kids come home. I'm looking forward to it at 5 o'clock today. Pray for me. We got the whole bunch coming like we always do, and it's going to be nice to see all these kids and to hear their chatter and talking about all their stories and being able to eat together. Oh my, it is something when your children come home. There's a fourth lesson I want you to see, Dad, and this is the one that I really want to focus on. In verses 20 and 21, number four, fathers should be forgiving. If you notice in these verses, in verses 20 and 21 and on, he took his son back as though nothing happened. Would you please note that in that story? He took the son back as though nothing had happened. He'd done spit his inheritance. He'd done lived in the gutter. He had done it all. And here he is in the presence of his father. And he took him back. Of course, we know from the teachings of Jesus that this is the teaching of the Heavenly Father, how he can take us back. How he can take us in, forgive us as though nothing had ever happened. This may be something we all need to do with our children. This may be absolutely something. I remember, I've often thought about TJ. This is my oldest, our oldest. And I've often thought what kind of job I did with him. I'm afraid I was a little too rough on him. Have you been rough on your kids? Firstborn, isn't it the firstborn? Boy, we had to learn some stuff. And he took the blunt. He took the blunt of all of it. And I've often wondered how he felt about that. And TJ wasn't perfect. And there were some things I had to forgive him about. Some of the things he did. But this right here is probably, and I don't want all my kids to know this, so don't say anything. This right here is probably the best Father's Day gift I've ever received from any of them. And it's a picture of a wise-looking chicken hawk or something. I want to say owl, but it don't look like no owl. Looks like a red-tailed hawk. And it says on the front, he says, "You taught me so much, Dad." He said in the card, it says, "Sometimes I catch myself saying the same things to my kids that you used to say to me." And that's when I start to feel really grateful, because it's like you're here right next to me, teaching me, supporting me, and guiding me all over again. I love you, Dad. Happy Father's Day. And he was a grown man when he sent me this. And he wrote a little note. Listen to this. "Dad, as I get older, I find myself becoming more like you. And that makes me very proud. And I know I have some pretty big shoes to fill. Thank you for all that you've done for me. I love you. Love TJ." Dads, there's something about forgiveness. There's something about making things right that makes things right. Billy Graham died, let's see, 2018, something like that. Yeah, it was 2018. And Charlotte and I and Mac Morris and Kathy Morris, they were spending the night with us. And Mac and Kathy and Charlotte and myself, after supper, we came in and I had taped it. We watched the memorial service of Billy Graham. He had speakers, of course. I mean, he'd passed away, I think, 2 weeks earlier. But out of all those speakers that really got our attention, it was the daughter. The daughter got up, and she told this story about her daddy. She said, I was getting married to a man out in California. And she said, my dad encouraged me not to marry that man. And she said, I tried to listen, but, you know, I couldn't, didn't want to. And she said, I went ahead and married the man. And he told me that I would probably regret it. And it would ruin my life. But she said he said it in love. She said, make a long story short, sure enough, we got a divorce. And I hit rock bottom, lost everything I had. And she said, I called my daddy and said, Daddy, I want to come home. He said, you come on. And you know, Billy Graham and Ruth, they lived in North Carolina up on a mountain. And she said when she finally got there and started making her way up that mountain in her car, and it, when it began to level off and got to where she was going to park, she said there stood her daddy out there waiting on her. And she said she got out of the car and walked up to him. Instead of saying, I told you so, and this and that, she said, he put his arms around me and said, welcome home. Fathers should be forgiving, compassionate. You can't beat that. Let's pray. Father, thank you for being our Heavenly Father. Thank you for this story that we can see your love and your grace so much. What it means to come home to you. But Lord, thank you. We can also see how we need to be as dads. Lord, I pray for that father today that may have a prodigal. I pray that that prodigal will come home soon. Give that dad grace and strength as he waits. I pray for that son or daughter that may be here today and they are that prodigal. Their dad may not be here, maybe in another town. I pray that this message has said something to them, spoken to them, maybe to the point that they will go and make things right with their dad. What a day, Lord. What a day that we can make things right with one another. What a day we can make things right with our dads. What a day that we can make things right with our children. Lord, again, you give us such a beautiful illustration of your love and compassion and forgiveness. How we desire to be like you. Help us to be more like you, our Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name, amen.